have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the ground. This is not a mean task. I mean, this is not an ordinary task. It's something that is weighty, but it's something that is possible and that can only be achieved when we are conscious of the fact that I must, on purpose, maximize these days. Hallelujah. Now, let's move a step higher. We saw God in Genesis chapter 1 creating the heavens and the earth. And after that, he rested, and the story of mankind started from there. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and all of that. But I want us to take also something from the habit in quote now, that God exhibited later on towards the end. Let's go, Revelation chapter 1. No, in the book of beginnings, Genesis. Let's go to the book of ending, Revelation. Hallelujah. Revelation chapter 1. Let's read verse 8. Revelation chapter 1, verse 8. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord, who is and who was and who is to come. Who is and who was and who is to come. Now, God briefly described himself as far as time is concerned in this particular verse. From this verse, we can see three clear distinctions of the timing in which God more or less exists. It says the Lord, who is and who was and is to come. Those things are the past, the present, and the future. Hallelujah. God is saying that as his child, who is here in this world, as a child of God, who is on the journey of life with God, your earthly journey can be classified into three distinct types, three distinct groups, three distinct ways, so to say. And that is the past, the present, and the future. Each and every one of us seated here, no matter our age, the level at which we are, our life's journey can be put into these three categories. We have a past. We have a present. Even I dare say that a child born yesterday, as we are talking now, he already has a past. And he has a present. And he has a future. And therefore, in order to really get the best out of life, we must know how to relate with these three areas of our lives. We must know that, how do we do it that we maximize each of these three areas so that one does not disturb the other? One does not hinder us from becoming who God wants us to be. The past, the present, and the future. Quickly, let's look at these areas. Now, when we talk about the past, it means that anything that happened before now, that is our past. And what we need to learn, what we need to take hold of concerning our past is this. We must never live in the past. Hallelujah. We must never live in the past. Rather, we learn from the past. God is asking each and every one of us that as we journey through life, yes, we have a past. Some things that happened in our past. Some very good, not very good, ugly experiences and all of that. But for a child of God who wants to maximize his days, we must not live in the past. We must not be too conscious of whatever happened in the past. We must let it go. However, we must learn from it. We must learn from the past. We must allow the past to teach us what is also possible in the future. So, we look at the past in that way. Now, I said some things might be so glorious, some things might be so bad. God is asking us that whatever it is, let the past be consigned to the past. I've told us, however, we learn from it. But then, let us forget the glory of the past. We forget his glory. We also forget its mistakes. Hallelujah. We're saying this because as human beings, you know, we're also three-dimensional. We have a spirit, we have a soul, and we have a body. We live in the body. And the body and our soul, our mind, will want to always recollect the past. In fact, some things that had been done in the past will want to encroach into our present. But God has given us grace to be able to forget the glory and forget the mistakes too. You know, when we talk about mistakes, grammatically speaking, it's one word, mistake. But somebody broke it down and said, when we make mistakes, we miss what we should have taken. And then we'll take what we should have missed. Hallelujah. So, you see now, oh, what a mistake. I shouldn't have done that. You have taken what you should have missed out. Oh, I should have taken that opportunity. I messed up. I did what I shouldn't have done. Please, let us confine that to the past and face the present that we are in. Let's see an example in the scripture. Are we there? Let's go to the book of Ephesians. Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. The book of Philippians chapter 3. Forgetting the past, its glory and its mistakes, not living there. Not settling down there. We're saying this because you see many believers, all we go about is just, oh, it was glorious. I did this. Oh, that ceremony was great. I got that award. And 2 years, 5 years down the line, I got that award. There was a man, true life story. This man walked up to my pastor and said, sir, I've come to see you. It was during counseling. He said, sir, do you know what? I made money. Though I made that money in the wrong way. I think he carried cocaine or something. One terrible business. And he said, when money was money, at least he could count cash, 10, 12 million, thereabout, that he could have as cash. But that he squandered it. And as at the time he was speaking to him, he brought out a CD. And he said, sir, all I have to show for that money is in this CD. And what is in that CD? Parties that he attended and where musicians sang his praises. He said, this is all I have to show. But now things are bad, things are terrible. I don't know where to start. I'm thinking of committing suicide. And he said, you don't have to do that. Let the past go. Forget those mistakes. For some people, it's about the glory. They settle down on a testimony or a few testimonies and we carry that too far. But God is saying, I am God who was. I was in the past. But I am now and I am to come. There is still a future ahead. Hallelujah. So let's go there with the Philippians chapter 3. Let's read from verse 12. It says, not that I've already obtained all this. This was Apostle Paul talking. Not that I've already obtained all this or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Verse 13. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead. Hallelujah. You could see that. Apostle Paul said, as a minister, as an ambassador of Christ, I forget what is in the past. This man performed miracles. At the same time, he had problems. If you read the book of 1 Corinthians, don't know which chapter, he said, I was flogged 39 times. I was shipwrecked. All this happened to me, but I'm straining ahead. I forget the past. Hallelujah. So let's look at our lives like that. As we behold another year, as we step ahead in life, please, the glories of this year and the years behind, let's forget them. The mistakes of the past, let's forget them. However, let's learn from them. Hallelujah. Let's go forward. The next thing is, you know, we said the past the present and the future. What do you do with your present? We live in the present. God is asking us, as we forget the past, we must engage the present. For any child of God that is on a journey that will make impact in life, we must engage the present. We must live life to the fullest in the present that we are. Engaging the present there is talking about seizing the opportunities, being alive now with all that we have, all our minds, all our hearts, all that God has ever given unto us. Let us use those things to engage the present. That is our responsibility. Yes, the present might be challenging, but we have the grace, hallelujah, to be able to overcome. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Let's quickly open that. The book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We'll come back to that Philippians. But 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Still, this man wrote this. The man mightily used by God. That's Apostle Paul. He said this. Are we there? 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 10. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace to me was not without effect. No. I worked harder than all of them. Yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. Hallelujah. Brethren, as we behold next year, as we round up this year, let's know one thing. The grace of God is available unto us. It's with us. And is asking us not to waste that grace. The grace of God upon his or her life to be in vain. He said, but no, I don't do that. But I labored more abundantly. More abundantly in order to secure the future. Hallelujah. It is not time to give excuses. Oh, this was not good. This person did this. This government was this. They will always be like that. But I think we need to know one thing. We are on a journey with the Lord. Your life is an individual journey with the Lord. You know, Apostle Paul told us, he said, for we shall all stand before the judgment throne of Christ, each one to receive whatever he has done, for whatever he has done in the body. So it's a personal thing between you and the Lord. And the Lord is asking you, don't let my grace upon your life be in vain. Labor abundantly in the present. Engage the present. Hallelujah. Let us engage the present. Let us seize the opportunities. Let us be aware of what the present can yield unto us. As long as it is there, let's fill our days with quality actions. Quality actions. That's what we're saying here. Hallelujah. And then quickly, let's move ahead. The third one has to do with our future. We all have a future. Excuse me. We all have a future that we are straining towards, that we are running towards. And, you know, for a Christian, hope is a very, very important word in Christianity. Hope is a key word. And what does hope do? Hope gives us an assurance of the future. So, we have a future. And what should we do with that future? Number one, we must love that future. We must love the future. Hallelujah. Let's love the future that the Lord has made available, that he has set aside for us. We must love the future, and also we must aggressively move to it. We love the future and we aggressively move to it. Even when things don't seem to be working well now, know one thing, hope will not disappoint us. Hallelujah. As long as you have hope in the Lord, your future is great. Hallelujah. Let me tell your neighbor, your future is great. Hallelujah. We have a future no matter who we are, no matter the level. You can see something. We were told. Can I remember now? When did God call Moses? At what age? I think it was around 80. 80. We've seen examples of people, 70-something, that the Lord would just put in their heart, you know, I want you to do something for me. I want you to work on this issue for me. Have this ministry impact these people, and you will see elderly people saying, I will go for it. That's a future. Don't ever think that Everything is ending now. There is a future, hallelujah, set aside for you and I. And what we should do is to love that future and aggressively and passionately move towards it, hallelujah. We were told that when you wake up, like I was once told, it says, some people, when they wake up, the song is, oh, what a day, another day. But some people say, thank God, it's another day. So we look forward to a future that the Lord has given unto us. Let's turn back to that Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. You know, we read about Apostle Paul saying that, "In I forget the past." Are we there? Philippians chapter 3, verse 12. Verse 12. Not that I've already obtained all this, or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of what God has in Jesus Christ took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead. Verse 14. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. And he rounds up like this in verse 15. All of us who are mature should take such a view of things. Hallelujah. All of us who are mature should take such a view of things. Of what? Look, each and every one of us. You know, there is this word in Christianity that seems controversial and is subject to various interpretations. And that word is destiny. Oh, that's his destiny. Oh, what's my destiny? And all of that. But one thing is this. God told us, Jeremiah 29, 11, "For I know the thoughts I have for you, says the Lord. Thoughts of good and not of evil, to give you a life and a hope." Now, God has a destiny set aside for you. He has a purpose for bringing me into this world. He has a purpose for bringing you into this world. And blessed is that man. Blessed is that woman. Blessed is that child of God who is able to quickly appropriate and identify that purpose and walk towards it. Hallelujah. So, as we look at the future, we walk towards our purpose. We aggressively walk towards it. We passionately walk towards it. That, Lord, I will accomplish this for you. Apostle Paul said, I had wasted time. He had persecuted the church. But now that God has given me another opportunity, I will not waste time. Will you waste time to run after that for which Christ got hold of you, for which you were born into this world? We're not here to just, like Apostle Paul said, if you are here just to live in this present world and nothing thereafter, we are of all men most miserable. But we have a responsibility. God is going to judge us. What impact are you going to make? What significance will your life be? Of what significance will it be when it is considered in its totality? It's not only about money and material things. We have an example in the scripture. A man who ran after money and material things, but at the end of it all, said, vanity upon vanity. All is vanity. Or is it knowledge? It's all vanity. Let me make you laugh. You know, I did my PhD at the University of Ibadan. So there was this day, I was just reading through the scripture, and I saw Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 12. Honestly, please, can we quickly look at it? Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 12. You know, yes, I'm a doctoral student and all of that. Hallelujah. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 12. Look at it. And further, my son, be admonished by this. Another translation says, beware of this, of making many books. There is no end. And much study is wearisome to the flesh. Hello. And you know, that time I had this sister, you know, she's my cousin. She's a professor too. So what happened was that she just took me when I said, yes, I want to enter university. She said, which course? I said, no, you are going to read this. I said, okay. And she took me to one of our friends in UI. Said, this is my brother. He's not living here until he gets his PhD. And I innocently, I said, okay. And I entered 83. I didn't leave until 94. 11 years from BSc to PhD. But when the holidays will come, she was 36, 37. And I will look at her and gray hairs. So when I saw that, I said, no wonder she started gray at that. Of making many, that's not to say that we should not study, right? But of making many books, there is no end. And much study will weary your flesh. It will disturb your mind. It will do all that. And so there's no big deal, you know. All these things, let's calm down. The only thing that will count is what we do for the Lord and for people. What impact with your life will your life make? That's what matters most. Hallelujah. You will leave all of that behind. I think it was last year, a colleague of mine, he passed on, he died. And the family, the wife and the children, they were abroad. So when they came, they saw books. And what would they do with it? They didn't need it. But so as not to just throw it away, just say, oh yeah, school department, take. He just dashed it away. Certificate, where will it be? So let's maximize our days, especially with things that matter. Hallelujah. Now, quickly, let's keep running ahead. Now, the important thing about these three areas, you know, we have seen these three compartments, the past, the present, and the future. The law, there is a law that Jesus gave, and that law, he gave us in form of parable. And that law, that parable, is the parable of the sower. You remember? The sower went to sow. The law of sowing and reaping honestly controls these three areas. That's what I want us to note this morning. The law of sowing and reaping. For whatsoever a man sows, that he shall reap. The present that we're living in honestly was dictated by the past things that you did. So the past seed will give rise to what you are going through in the present. And the present seed you are sowing will give rise to the future that you will get. Hallelujah. In all areas of life. Spiritual, marital, finance, career, relationships. Let's be mindful of the law of sowing and reaping. And that is why, as a farmer, you must deliberately say, I will sow good seeds in the present. Hallelujah. So that I'll be able to secure a great future. Now, the other thing is this. Each and every one of us, when we consider the totality of all of this, you know, I said we must engage the present. In terms of engaging the present, I want to challenge us this morning that as we go through life, we must on purpose dedicate a portion of time to every area of our lives, knowing that whatsoever you sow now is what you will meet in the future. Please, dedicate a chunk of your time to each of the areas of our lives. Don't let us just look at time and our days as a fragment and not consider the totality of it. What am I saying? As a child of God, you should know that God is interested in your spiritual growth. Like someone said, I read a book and the book says that God is more interested in your character than in your comfort. But many of us, we are too much interested in our own comfort. Oh Lord, don't look at me like this. Oh Lord, do this, that this, give me this, give me that. But let us look at life in totality. The family aspect, relationships with people, and dedicate a chunk of your time to each of these areas. Don't let it be too skewed to one. Run after only money. Some is only after career. Some is only after family. Like I went to his friend's wedding. I wasn't the best man. I went to a very close friend. And the chairman of the reception said, look, wife, allow him to go out. Allow him to express himself. Don't just cage him in, thinking that it's only love wanting thing all the time. You must live life. Yes, he will dote on you. Yes, he will express love. But please, allow him to also do some other things. Don't let us be too skilled to a particular thing. And then The other one that I want to quickly emphasize is the issue of our personal development. We must give time to our personal development. That's what we mean by maximizing your days. Looking at the totality of your life and dedicating a portion of time to each of these areas. I've outlined a few. Our spiritual lives, our personal development, our families, our careers, our relationships with other people, extended family, friends, our service unto the Lord, service in church, service to people, being of blessing to the kingdom of God and to mankind. Because all of this, the totality of all of this, is what makes for a successful child of God. When that time will come that you will look back, just like God did at the end of creation, that you will look back at life, you will look back at life in the totality of all of these areas. There was a man, I read his book, and he was talking about a man, businessman, very successful, but on his dying bed, he looked around. There was no child there. His children were all gone. His wife was gone because he didn't devote time to his family. It was all about business and money and chasing this and that. And on his deathbed, he was really miserable. He was miserable. He didn't like what happened at the end. Why? He failed to give time to the important things and not the urgent. Quickly, I hope that we know there's a difference between the two. There are important things in life. We have outlined a few of them. But there are also some urgent things in life. If care is not taken, the urgent things will prevent us from taking our time on the important things. For instance, the very important thing is about our personal development. Who are you on the inside? But many of us, do we take time to read? Do we take time to meditate? Hallelujah. Do we take time to study so that we will, like Paul told Timothy, you will show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed. Hallelujah. I'll tell you something as I round up that happened about a few weeks ago when I came here. There was a wedding that took place in the other hall there, and I was in this premises. You know, we sat down, we're waiting for the program to commence, and I came with about two friends, and we sat down, we're talking, the three of us, and we acknowledged and appreciated one thing that, you know, to some extent, I know Pastor Francis, and that my friend, one of them was coming here probably for the first time, and when he saw, excuse me, the posters, the displays, the things spread all over, he was marveled, and he said, look, is this? And I said, yes, it's also a church. Say, this is a church? And you could see all these ones. Why? To learn from. But while we were saying that, we saw some elderly people, about three of them. They were taking in, they were going to each of those stands. Let's call them stands. Each of those stands. And they were reading. And one papa, maybe late 60s or early 70s, took out his phone and he was taking pictures. But you know what? We now say something. That do you know that it is possible that there will be a teenager or a 20-something-year-old in this premises who has not taken time to go to see those things? Hello? Is it possible? It's very possible. And that is the new generation. It's so instructive that all those people, honestly, three, four of them, they were elderly people. And we remarked that this was what happened in the past. That's the generation of leaders. And they still had it even until that old age. But what do we have today? Don't let's go there. You know, one here, and the one here. You know what I mean? That's all there is to life. Like one of those companies. You know this, eh? Data is life. Say, ha, data is life. Okay. But let's commit to personal development. If you go, I once bought, I didn't buy, I saw the nylon. And the woman selling the clothes, you know, he said, you are what you wear. That's what they put on that nylon for the boutique. And I said, this is what I said, no, I am not what I wear. You are not what you wear. You are what you know. Personal development. Because that is one major thing that will push you ahead in life. So please, let's create time for it. Let's identify time for these areas, for our family lives. Let's build great families. It's only when you apportion time like this that we can say that you are maximizing your life. That you are allowing the days, the time that God has given you to impact every area of your life. As we move ahead, there's one other thing that I want us to take note of. Please, let's go to the book of Proverbs chapter 25. Proverbs chapter 25. Hallelujah. Maximizing your days. Proverbs 25. Let's read two verses there. Verse 16. Proverbs 25 from verse 16. Proverbs 25 from verse 16. Two verses, 16 and 17. Are we there? It says, if you find honey, eat just enough. Too much of it, and you will vomit. Verse 17. Seldom set foot in your neighbor's house. Too much of you, and he will hate you. These two verses, we can summarize it in one thing. Please, if you want to maximize your time, if you want to really be an effective utilizer of what God has given you in terms of time, beware of addiction. Beware of addiction. What is addiction? Addiction is something that you engage in and you lose sense of time. You do it and time does not count. That's addiction. It steals our time. It prevents us from maximizing the days that God has given unto us. You are doing something, and while you are doing it, you forget about time. That's tending towards addiction. It will not allow you to maximize your days in all of the areas of life. So, beware of it. Beware of it. God is asking you and I, like Apostle Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. His grace to me was not in vain. No, I labored abundantly. So as we engage the present, no matter, let's be conscious of it, that addiction will not be my portion. I will make sure that I'm conscious of what I do. He has given us intellect and everything we will need, everything that pertains to life and godliness. We have them. But you see, we live in a flesh that wants to also express itself. We live in a world that wants to take hold of us. It might be television. It might be all this social media. I read somewhere, you know, somebody just posted in a school. It was in a school. And they said, close Facebook and face your book. Hello. Close Facebook and face your book. That's for those, because it can get to a level of addiction. Even games, anything, but beware of it. Anybody who is engaging in it is not maximizing his or her days, and God will not be happy with such a life. And finally, be an effective judge of your time. All these ones that we have said, God is asking you and I that because of his faithfulness, he will give us long life. Hallelujah. But he wants us to fill those days with good quality actions. When we do, those long years will then become what he called length of days. He said, for length of days, he will give you. Length of days, that the word length there, is telling us that it's not just the 24 hours, but in terms of what is in those days, they are really long. They are not short. So length of days. And what we're saying is, each and every one of us, let us be our own judge. Let's judge the use of our time. Be your own critique. Hallelujah. Evaluate yourself regularly. God did at the beginning, oh no, at the end of every day, and he saw that it was good. And at the end of the 6 days, he saw that everything was good. Nobody can do it for you. Rather, people can challenge you at times or ask questions, especially your spouse can do that, a parent can do that to a child, but then he has given you that responsibility that you sit down and you evaluate how has it been. And in evaluating, quickly, let me drop this. You know, we were told in chapter 1 of the book of Genesis, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. And he separated evening, and there was also darkness, evening and morning. You know something? You know that, scripturally speaking, yes, we are male and female. God created them male and female. But really, in the spirit realm, we are all the same. And we call us man, right? M-A-N. And that M-A-N is something. M is for morning. A is for afternoon. N is for night. We're supposed to operate in the morning, in the afternoon, and at the night time. Hallelujah. The thing is this. How are you using your morning? How are you using your afternoons? How are you using your nights? Hello. Let's, in evaluating ourselves, let's look at it. Some of us, we wake up very early. 5 a.m., some 4:30, you are up, you are doing. But are you filling it with good things? Ask yourself. Good. But the other thing is also, what about afternoon? Are they really, really dull times? Even though you might be at work, are those periods filled with gisting? Some of us, we work in places where productivity is not really the insane. Hello, can we be real? Especially, I'm sorry. Huh? Let me say sorry before I say it. Especially civil servants. Hello, public service in Nigeria. Yes, of course, there are a few productive ones. But majority is just a case of I go, I do some things, and I'm in the wako. Unlike private sector, your afternoons and then your night season, are you utilizing them? When you sit down, some people, quickly you go to work in the morning. I know somebody like that. By 8:30, she's already feeling sleepy. 8:30, and it's gone. And I said, come. If you review it very well, your night seasons are not being well utilized. Yes, eventually you must sleep, but it's recommended 6 to 8 hours. Though for the really productive ones, they keep cutting down on that one more and more. I hope you know that. And when we pray, Lord, promote me, increase me. Lord, I shall be the head. Pastor Francis came to our church and said that thing. He said, when you go to camp, you will see, Lord, uplift, lift me up, bless me. But are they prepared for that upliftment? That's the question. If God uplifts you, if he promotes you, it will chop into your nighttime. All those 6 hours, 7 hours, 8 hours of sleep, it may not be possible again. No. I hope you know that. Can you handle promotion? So, in evaluating ourselves, let's look at the morning, the afternoon, and the night. If you see that maybe the night is full of more of television, you know, addiction to TV, addiction to this, let's cut them down. Let's fill our days. Because remember, the law of sowing and reaping. Whatever you put into the present as you engage it will determine the future that you will arrive at. It's no magic. God cannot be mocked. For whatsoever a man sows, that he shall reap. Hallelujah. And as I round up, I want to say, find a role model and benchmark your life against this role model. Yes, we have role models in the scripture. We read the Bible, we look at them. But in addition, let's look at our surroundings. Do you see somebody doing well in your area of calling? Do you know somebody that is really effective in putting things into the day? I give you an example. There is this man. It's a known figure in this country. He had occupied a very important position. And he called us to a meeting. And on that day, we were there, about 10 of us at the meeting. And on the agenda paper, there were 7 items there. 7 items on the agenda paper. And he said, well, the ladies and gentlemen, have you seen the agenda paper? It will not really be a long meeting. Hopefully, within the next 45 minutes, we should be out of here. I said, what? 45 minutes. 7 items. In some other climb, 7 items here, we are still there for the next 3-4 hours. Take this way. But, brethren, do you know what? We finish at the exact 40 minutes and we touch every of those items. This man, he has written books, he has done this, he's effective. Today, he's in Singapore, he's in this, he's applying. And I was taken in and I said, wow, this is something that one must emulate. Not wasting time at meetings, being straight to the call. That is how you get better and better in life. And then we'll be able to pack so much into it. There was this thing about that my pastor said. He said, look, some people, you can write all their life's endeavors in a 2A exercise book. And that 2A will be such that he was born, he went to school, he came back, he got a job, he got married, and he went to work, he came back, he had a child, he went to work, he ate, he slept, he came back. After 2 pages, you know what will follow? Ditto, ditto, ditto. Ditto, ditto. You know ditto now? The same routine. He went to work and he came back. He ate and he slept. He went to work and he came back. He ate and he slept. And he had a child. And they did naming ceremony. He went to work and he came. No. God is more than that. You are here for a purpose more than that. Hallelujah. Not even in this kind of environment. Hallelujah. We are challenged to be our best. Hallelujah. In this journey that we are on, we must grow this. We must share it and we must live it. We must continue to embark on things that will make God himself to be happy for putting us into this world. Hallelujah. Will you maximize your days? Will you put in all that God has given inside of you? Allow them to come out as you look at the years ahead. Let's know that the journey is a good one. God is our senior partner. He will be with us. Hallelujah. When we seem failing, when life wants to take its toll on us, he will help us. Hallelujah. And he will help us to arrive at a good very end in the name of Jesus. Shall we bow down our heads as we pray this morning? Shall we bow down our heads as we commit ourselves unto him? We have the Holy Spirit inside of us. Let's say, Lord, thank you for this year. Thank you for this journey. We have started the journey with you. Thank you for how far you have led us. And Lord, as we look at the future, help us to engage the present. Help us to maximize the present. Help us to seize the opportunities in the present to be able to arrive at a great future. Lord, we aggressively and passionately move towards our future because we know that your plans and thoughts towards us are thoughts of good and not of evil. Each and every one of us here, we are asking Heavenly Father that you continue to guide us into that future. Even as we learn from our past and forget the glory and the shame and the mistakes in it. No, we will not be held down by it, but we will strain ahead. We will push ahead to lay hold of that for which you have sent us into this world. Help us not to live a life of by and by, but help us to live a significant life. A life that will make impact into your kingdom, in your kingdom and in the lives of people. We commit ourselves to you more this day. We are asking you for your assistance, for your help, for your leading. That as we go on in this life, Heavenly Father, help us not to waste our time. Help us not to waste our days, but help us to have length of days added to us day by day. Help us to fill those days that you will give unto us with quality actions, quality thinking, quality understanding, Heavenly Father, such that we will accomplish things for you. Lord Jesus, you came into this world, and the Bible makes us to understand that the things you did within those 3.5 years of ministering, that even the books in the whole world cannot contain them. But we are asking that you share a part of this with us, Heavenly Father. Holy Spirit, nudge us. Tell him, say, nudge me. Push me ahead. Holy Spirit, will surrender to you this morning. Push us where need be. Challenge us. remind us of things we have had. Show us what to do. Push us ahead to do what is right. Heavenly Father, we yield ourselves unto you one more time. Please take care of us. Push us ahead. Move us in the right direction. Help us, O Lord, to regularly evaluate ourselves, to look at our lives, and to become better, Heavenly Father. To number our days aright, and by so doing, apply our hearts unto wisdom. We want to be wise in the affairs of life. Because when we do this, our failure rates will go down and you'll be happy with us. We want to live lives that will make you happy. We want to live lives that will make people happy. That your kingdom and humanity will be blessed as a result of our being here. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Because next year shall be a glorious one for us. Even as we fulfill our days, as we add length unto our days, Heavenly Father, we bless your holy name, O Lord. In Jesus' worthy name we have prayed.